come to share our air conditioning today. I think it's going to get warm, but it's great to have you here. You are a guest at New Hope today. You have honored us, and we hope that you move from guest status to family status very, very quickly. I'd love to have you be a part of what goes on around here on a regular basis. But if you're a guest today, there are cards in the pew. Love for you to grab one, fill it out, and drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. And next week, through the mail, we're going to let you know what goes on around here. We try not to irritate you, but we want to give you enough information that you can make a good decision about whether you'd like to be on that or not. So thanks for being here today. It is warming up, isn't it? How many of you went to graduations this last week? Raise your hand. All right. How many of you got some more graduations to go to this week? Raise your hand. Okay, good. Busy times for graduates, all right? And a great time. We will be acknowledging all of our high school graduates next week, all right? We also try to squeeze in college a little bit too, but high school gets our primary attention next Sunday, so we'll have gifts. We'll call them by name, and if we don't know their name, we'll still call them up and give them a gift. It's just a major moment in all their lives. So thanks for being involved in all the graduates' lives and your family and friends. Yo!
Can you turn your microphone on?
Can I turn my, you can't hear me? You can hear me? All right. Oh, yeah. I guess there's a button here. Hello?
Better.
Testing, 1, 2. All right. Now I'm a turned on pastor. All right. Anyway, it's great to see you out today. Let me highlight a couple of things that are going to be coming up, and then I got a couple of things that I want to chat with you about this morning during our life in the church. Number one, please be sure not to run over any of the parking posse. All right, third week, you ought to be getting used to them by now. All right, they're still tweaking some things, but they're doing it for our safety and for first-time guests coming in, particularly to the 1045 service to help with the traffic flow a bit. So thank you so much. It's between these next two services that they are at greatest risk and trying to do the best help. So thank you for paying attention to the guys in the bright yellow and orange vests. Number two, Lewis's. Would you stand real quickly? All right, Kathy and Jerry. All right. Now sit down. All right, did it quick. This might be the last Sunday they'll be with us for a while. Their house sold. They are moving back to Austin, Texas, and they'll be leaving to look for a place there, and then they'll be back, but unsure if they'll get back here. So hug them. Tell them you'll be praying for them. You'll be missing them. And if we don't see them again this side of eternity, we got all eternity to celebrate with them. But it's been great to have them back home, and it'll be great to have them come home to visit us from time to time. So it's great. If it were not for the Lewises, small groups might not have got launched here at New Hope Church 2 years ago. They were the impetus that helped us get it off the ground, and we are so very, very, very grateful for that. Let me highlight a couple of things. Today is the first Sunday of the month, so after the 10:45 service at about 12:15 is our outreach with our homeless ministry. If you've never gone out on it, come back at about 12:15. They'll gather over here in the bridge, and you don't need to know anything. Just show up, and it's probably about a 2 to 2.5 hour process that they're engaged in, and that happens the first Sunday of every month. This coming Tuesday is our senior luncheon, second Tuesday of the month, special guest. It's always good food. There's always great friends to spend time with. There's an excellent program this time, and that is you got Phil Wright and Pops, who are going to be sharing about their honor flight trip, all right, going back to Washington, D.C. a couple of months ago. And Phil's great-grandson was one of the journalists on the trip, and he's put together a wonderful picture show, so you'll get to see pictures of what went on as well, so it should be a great luncheon. And then this coming Saturday is the men's breakfast, all right, at 8 o'clock, and Phil and Dad, they're kind of the Cheech and Chong around New Hope. They're going to be on the program for the Saturday service as well. Yeah, Dad wasn't too sure he liked that Cheech and Chong reference, all right, in the last service. So, but anyway, should be great times both Tuesday and on Saturday. Next Sunday afternoon is our widow's brunch lunch, all right? Ladies, if you are a widow, want to meet some other ladies in the church, all right, then show up at that lunch. It's at the Great Wall, all right, the Chinese restaurant this time at Fowler and Herndon. They choose different places, but would love to have you join them for lunch that day. Vacation Bible School, and I have one sign-up sheet. There should be another clipboard, and somebody's going to find this other clipboard for me, right? It was over in the other building on the counter, so we make sure it goes down both sides. Both things on this clipboard pertain to one event, and that is Vacation Bible School, which begins the last couple of days of June and creeps through the 3rd of July. Yeah, next Sunday afternoon after the last service, so at about 12:15, there's going to be a free lunch for those of you who would like to know how you can volunteer and be available to help out during Vacation Bible School. Remember, I don't like to use the word volunteer anymore, so we're still educating my own mind and educating you that I'm not going to say volunteer anymore. We're looking for folks who'll be willing to be available to serve Christ in various ways, all right? Because we're not doing this as a benefit for ourselves. We are doing this as a kingdom ministry. So if you want to serve food, if you want to prepare food, if you want to teach a lesson, if you want to assist teachers, if you want to be involved in outdoor activities, all kinds of ways you can help at VBS, sign up so they have enough food for you, and they will share all that with you next Sunday. The bottom part of the list, these are things that they are going to be using during Vacation Bible School, supplies that would be very, very helpful that you could just drop off here as a donation for Vacation Bible School. So if you can help with that, sign up by those list items. So now we have one to go down each side. All right. Thank you, thank you, thank you. By the way, your softball team won this past week. All right. Yeah. After being slaughtered for a couple of weeks in a row, they finally got a win under their belts, all right? So that's great news. Fireworks booth will kick off also the 1st of July, and as you know, that is a fundraiser that goes to help high school kids going to summer camp and our Celebrate Recovery ministry. So keep your eyes open for the fireworks booth. There is a special meeting called. This pertains to all of you who are voting members of the church family. It pertains to all of you who are regular attenders. We like you to stay in the know. But the search committee for our next youth pastor, after paper screening over 100 resumes, after phone screening about another 15, narrowing that down to 4. We interviewed 4 over the last 3.5 weeks. And they came to a conclusion this weekend, and so that recommendation is being made to the board this coming week, and would like to bring that recommendation to the entire church family a week from this coming Wednesday night. So not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday. A special call meeting, 7 p.m. in the evening, and would love to have you here. That's the only item of business on that agenda, particularly if you have high schoolers in your family, you want to come, your grandparents of high schoolers, you want to come, but this is a team ministry. As well, so it pertains to all of us. So we would love to have you here. His name is Chris Bishop. He and his wife Melody have 2 small children. They are from Southern California in the Riverside, Ontario area. He's a PK. Don't hold that against him. Been engaged in youth ministry for about 12 years, has a degree in music with a minor in youth ministry, and this is his heart's passion. And he has been very diligent in his pursuit of us, as well as our investigation of him. And so we'll be excited to present him to you on Wednesday evening, the 17th. And they will be present for that meeting that evening. So please put that date on your calendar. Now, I want to take a moment to visit about something. I don't often do, but sometimes there are things going on in our culture that we need to be aware of. Often I don't draw a lot of attention because things can spike quickly and go away quickly, and I hate to draw more attention to them. But there are some things that I believe also can potentially be very dangerous. And I knew nothing about this until Tuesday of this week, and it was brought up in our staff meeting. And Peggy did a little research on it. I was doing some research on it. And so it was of such a nature that I want to share with you, particularly if you are parents or grandparents of kids who are anywhere from 4th grade, really through high school. The biggest target audience is 5th, 6th, and junior high, but it can leak a little bit each direction. How many of you are familiar with something going on the internet called the Charlie Charlie Game or Charlie Charlie Challenge? Raise your hand. You are familiar. Okay, very few of you. So that's why I'm bringing it up. I'm going to recommend that all of you parents look at your kids' cell phones and internet use, okay, and look for the hashtag Charlie Charlie and see if they are engaged in it. For those of you my generation and older, if you are familiar with Kreskin's ESP and Ouija boards, okay, it's a similar format to that, except, you know, you as parents, you had to go out and buy them, or somebody's parents had to go out and buy the game for you to play with them. With this is accessible on the internet, and it tells you how to make your own game board. You use two pencils and a piece of paper with the words yes and no in four corners. And literally the activity is to invoke a demon from Mexico to come visit where you are and to answer the questions that you ask him. So it's rather dangerous. It has some. I understand a lot of kids. It will be just as Ouija boards and Kreskin's ESP was. It's just a spoof, but you also have the risk of young people who are very susceptible, and they open themselves up to a venue that will not be healthy for them. You also, as has been reported on some of the internet services that I found, children who have actually been terrified by what has happened, and they've had to provide counseling for them because of great fear that has come in contact with the demonic world. We don't talk about demons a whole lot. They exist. They're out there. This country has been blessed, I think, for 200 years because of the prevalence of its foundation and its roots in Christianity. The farther this nation moves away from that foundation, the more susceptible, as you will find in some of the Central American countries and in some of the countries in the country of Africa, where those things are much more prevalent, we open ourselves up to those kind of things. Let me see if I can put it in a perspective that maybe relates to us here. Smokey Bear, he is known for two famous quotes. What's the two quotes Smokey Bear is known for? Only you can prevent forest fires. And then there is a quote on a poster for years when I was a kid. Smokey Bear on it. Notice I don't say Smokey the Bear. Smokey Bear does not have a middle name called the. Okay? It's Smokey Bear is his name. All right? So there was a poster out. How do we prevent forest fires? By not doing what? Do you remember? Yeah. Smokey Bear says, don't play with matches. Okay, so if you want to prevent is there anything wrong with matches? No, matches in and of themselves are not a problem, but things happen often by accident, okay? Forest fires get started by playing with something that you shouldn't be playing with. That same thing that applies to forest fires, I think applies to this kind of game here, all right? We don't want our kids heading in a direction that would not be healthy for them. And on internet, it becomes popular instantaneously. The BBC reported that this hashtag has been used more than 2 million times since last Monday. 2 million times since last Monday. So I just simply want to say, be on guard. As wise adults put medicines in high places and safe places away from young children, as wise adults put poisons behind a locked cabinet, let's treat this as something that has the potential to be very, very dangerous. So I just simply wanted you to be aware of that today. All right, I'm going to ask our ushers to come wait on us today as we have our morning tithes and offerings. Folks, would you come? Would you join with me as we pray? Then we'll engage in our worship today. Father, I love you. It's great to be your child. It's great to wake up in the morning and know that we have the eternal love of an eternal God who doesn't just say it to us with lip service, but he has demonstrated it to us by the gift of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And that gift that we have received in the person of his Son was not beautifully wrapped. But Father, he was beaten and nailed to a cross. And he died so that I could have eternal life. And so, Father, I am so grateful for the demonstration of love, for the extent that you were willing to go to. And every morning we can wake up and say, we are loved. Father, thank you that as you live in us and as you love us, you began with our permission to shape, form, fashion our lives to reflect your nature and your character. Sometimes, Father, that permission we give you is hurtful. Sometimes you have to break hard hearts Sometimes you have to transform old habits. And all of those things come, Father, with confession. The Scripture says we must humble ourselves, confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and we will be saved. Father, you know the reason why men and women have come here today. You know what's going on in their world and their work and their family circles. Some are here because of the adventure of this past week. They could not wait to join their words and their voice of praise with others who are so grateful for what you have accomplished in them. There are others who've come here today because they've been driven here in spite of their circumstances. They have been driven here because they don't know where else to turn. And I trust, Father, that through the music and through the prayer and through your message, that, Father, they will know the answer by the time they leave of why they came today. It's not to be impressed with New Hope. It's not to be impressed with a worship team or a pastor. But, Father, it's to discover what you have to say to them. And I hope you will have the freedom to say it all today. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks. We commit this to you in the name of Christ. Amen. Hey, this has been a significant week for a variety of folks. I know the Littles have a brand new grandbaby, so that's pretty exciting stuff for them. So congratulations to them. The ladies met yesterday for breakfast around here and kind of revealed their secret buddies and signed up to do it again for next year or the next 6 months. And American Pharoah won the Triple Crown yesterday. First time in a long, long time. Though I do have to acknowledge the fact that horse still could not beat my graduating classmate, Secretariat, okay, still was 2.5 seconds behind his record, all right, of 1973. But that was pretty impressive yesterday. That was fun. Well, as exciting as grandbabies and revealing secret pals and seeing a horse win the triple count is, none of those provide us the answer to the question of what are we supposed to do when life flashes at us. Fasten your seatbelt. And that shows up at the most unexpected moments in our life. And if we want to have spiritual muscle memory, we need to know, first of all, what is it that we should do as soon as the fasten your seatbelt sign shows up, and what should we continue to be engaged in while that sign is still posted. So I invite you this morning to turn to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, and we are going to look at the third part of the recipe of what we are to do when those fasten your seatbelt signs pop up. 2 weeks ago, we discovered that when you're on a plane and the fasten the seatbelt sign is revealed, it's indicating one of three things. You're either taking off, you are landing, or in mid-flight, you are experiencing turbulence. All three of these times on an airplane are critical moments during a flight. All three of these moments are transition moments. Something is about to change. We know what to expect with takeoff. We know what to anticipate on landing. But mid-flight, when that fasten your seatbelt sign comes on, we have no idea what is next. We don't know what the pilot has seen that we don't know about. Things are now uncertain for us in the next several minutes. A man flew into Chicago one day and he hired a taxi to take him to downtown. As he was riding along in the taxi, they came to a red light and the driver blew right through it. And the man said, "Hey, that light was red, you're supposed to stop." And the driver said, "I know, but my brother does it all the time." Soon they came to a second red light, and the guy blew right through it. The guy said, "Hey, you're going to get us killed. That light was red." The driver said, "Don't worry about it. My brother does it all the time." And then they came to a green light, and the taxi driver stopped. And the man said, "What are you doing? The light's green. Now's the time to go. Why don't you go?" And the answer, the driver said, "I know it's green, but you never know when my brother is here." Life's uncertain sometimes. Sometimes it seems as if all the world is going on red and stopping on green. We're constantly trying things in our life that don't work. But God's truth does work. And so when the fasten your seatbelt sign comes on, 2 weeks ago we learned the first response that you and I should have when the fasten your seatbelt light comes on, when uncertainty looms up in front of you, what should be our first response? Pray. And though we often go to prayer, we often pray in the hopes that God will change our world, that God will change our circumstances. But what is it that we usually find out happens when we pray? God changes us. It's not about God changing the situation or the circumstance. It's really about, God, what do you need to do in me at this moment? Prayer is not about changing things. Prayer is about being changed. And by the way, remember 2 weeks ago in that same sermon I told you my little pet peeve about bumper stickers, prayer changes things? In case I didn't mention it in the 9:15 service, I know I did in the 10:45. 450 prophets of Baal, 400 prophets of Asheroth did what all day long? They prayed. And it didn't change one thing, did it? See, that's why it's important to understand the principle. Prayer is not what changes things. God does. It's who you are praying to. And that's what's important for us to understand. Prayer isn't really about things being changed. It's about us being changed. Changed so that we can trust our Heavenly Father with the things that only He can control. Changed so that we are free from decisions that will only complicate our lives. When we need direction, this is where we should go to for directions. It limits some of the options that are out there, and that limiting those options are sometimes quite good for us. Number three, change because we have placed into God's hands what only God's hands are capable of handling. Last week, we talked about the second thing we need to do when the fasten your seatbelt sign goes on, and we discover that we are not in control. There are things that we would love to forget. There are some things we can't afford to forget. So, along with prayer, what's the second thing we are to do when the fasten your seatbelt sign comes on? Remember. Good. You all remembered. Amazing. That's right. Uncertainty has a way of focusing us so exclusively on the mystery of what lies before us that we forget about what lies behind us. If you have been a Christian for any length of time, God's faithfulness to you in the past should cast a long shadow onto our future. God's faithfulness to us in the past should shape our attitude of assurance and our perspective about the future. We should have learned by now to rest in the shadow of God's past provision so that when the fasten your seatbelt sign comes on and uncertainty looms ahead of us, we should remember not to forget. And last week we looked at a character who forgot very quickly what he should have remembered. Who was that? Elijah. Yeah, Elijah. Elijah, in a matter of hours, was turned upside down. He forgot when he heard the threat of Jezebel. He forgot that hours before he had just won a duel on Mount Carmel against 850 false prophets. He had forgotten that for over 3 years, God had provided him food and water. He did it at the brook of Cherith with a raven. He did it in a widow's home in enemy territory. He had forgotten all of God's past provision as he faced this next looming moment in his future of uncertainty, and he spiraled down into discouragement and depression. Today we're going to look at part three of a four-part process of what you and I should be engaged in when the fasten your seatbelt light comes on. Today our key idea is this, that God will take care of our needs. In the meantime, we are to concern ourselves with His kingdom. Seek Him first. We pray, we remember, and we seek. Let's read the book of Matthew. Did I already give this to you? Matthew 6, beginning at verse 25. Matthew's easy to find, first book of the New Testament. It's tucked in there between Malachi and Luke. Okay, so the Gospel of Matthew chapter 6. If your Bible has red print in it, then where you were about to read from, we don't get to throw red print up on the screen. I guess we could, but we didn't. But if you would notice in your Bible, where we're going to read from is right in the middle of a sea of red print. You can go an entire page and a half before, and you can go almost another page after, and it's all red. Jesus doing maybe his longest sermon, all right, his longest discourse is what we're going to cut right into the middle of. And in this sermon that he preaches, all right, he covers the Beatitudes. He talks about how God wants to use us in this world as salt and light. He deals with some of the challenges of their culture, the fulfillment of the Old Testament law. He deals with subjects like murder and slander and divorce and oaths and revenge. And then he gets to the heart of a lot of what he had to say in life, and that is you are to love your enemies. He talks about caring for the needy and the poor. He discusses prayer and fasting. And then he talks about what's at the root of our life. Where are you putting your treasures? Are you holding on to earthly stuff that moth and rust will corrupt and that you can't take with you? Or with your life here on earth, are you investing in things that are being stored in heaven, where they'll never be destroyed? He challenges our motivation for life. And after he finishes that, he brings us to the point we want to look at today. And here's what Jesus says. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, about what you will eat or drink, or about your body or what you will wear. Is life not more important than food? And is the body more important than clothes? Check out the birds of the air. They don't sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they are? Who of you, by worrying, can add one single hour to your life? And why is it that you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today, and tomorrow it is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you? Oh, you of little faith. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father already knows you need them. But seek first what? His kingdom and his righteousness. And all these things, the food, the fashions, the funds, they'll be given to you as well. Therefore, don't worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. See, one of the things that ought to distinguish those of us who are believers in Christ, one of the things that should distinguish us as Christians is how you and I respond to uncertainty. Being a Christian doesn't eliminate uncertainty in our life. Being a Christian changes the way of how we approach uncertainty in our life. David said, when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he didn't avoid it, he had to walk through it. Jesus said, cast all your cares upon me because I care for you. He says, I'll be with you in those care-filled times. Will you acknowledge me? You see, a Christian in times of uncertainty ought to be HDTV. It ought to be high definition. It's at that moment that the world, that those who are not believers in Jesus Christ can see the difference that Jesus Christ makes. So uncertain moments are very important to the kingdom of God. So one of the things that's distinguished believers is how we respond to uncertainty. If you have noticed a difference in a believer, today I hope you're going to discover what it is that makes that difference. Uncertainty, like physical pain, has the potential to drive us towards self-centeredness. In uncertain times, who do we worry about? me. I become consumed with today and my needs and my wants. We begin to think in terms of survival and protecting what we have. When we finally get around to the first step, prayer, our prayers often sound like a shopping list, like we're talking to Santa Claus rather than to God. We say things like, God, provide this. God, bless me. God, give me. God, make such and such happen so things are better. The problem is we become so focused on our needs, our desires, and our particular situations, we lose sight of a big picture of what life is really all about. We see only a lower story perspective and not an upper story one. We miss the fact that God may be up to something and He wants us to be a part of it. Uncertainty backs us into a corner of self-centeredness, an unhealthy preoccupation with self. I hurt too much. I'm too sick. I'm getting too old. And we talk about those things as if God can't do something about them. When Jesus showed up on the scene and He preaches this sermon, He was surrounded by people whose felt needs were so pronounced that they couldn't get past them. At the time that Jesus showed up, the people were being taxed by an unjust government with no means of reform or protest. This was written 2,000 years ago. Sounds a little familiar, doesn't it? They were being led by hypocritical religious leaders that had sold out to Rome. They had their land and their wealth taken from them. There was no justice. Their children were being confused with the infusion of Roman and Greek values. They were poorer than they had been before. They felt abandoned by God, no Messiah, no kept promise. Jesus came to put the uncertainty of that day in proper perspective, and He comes to you today, if you are uncertain in your present situation, to give you His perspective. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, in the midst of this kind of environment, Jesus has the audacity to say this to a group of very needy people. He says, "Don't worry about your needs." Eh? None of you are old enough to remember that, huh? Don't worry, eh? Okay, that one went right over all of your heads. Google that one. Yeah, I'd be happy. Yeah, but yeah, that was a thing in Canada. Don't worry, eh? Yeah, don't worry, be happy. Anyway, the context of this passage, Jesus has just finished encouraging them to approach life with an eternal perspective. Lay up treasures where? At the bank? No. Lay up treasures in heaven. Eternal perspective, big picture. He focused on their money. He knew if He could get their attention on their money, possessions, and stuff, He might be able to get them to think eternally about everything else. For this reason, since we are supposed to think first eternally, He says, don't worry. This word worry means to be anxious, to have a fear of the future, which is unknown. Don't let those things consume your thoughts and occupy your emotions. He's not calling for irresponsibility. He is not saying, hey, don't just sit at home and wait for everything to drop in your lap. He's talking to reasonable people who know that the Bible also says if you don't work, you don't eat. But He's saying, hey, in the midst of what is reasonable life, don't worry. Don't sweat. Have a right perspective. He immediately sets up two categories of need that we are not to be anxious about. He looks at critical needs and He looks at non-critical needs. First thing about critical needs is our life, things pertaining to survival, like eating and drinking. And by the way, most of us in here don't look like we're having a whole lot of problem with either one of those issues. Some of us are worried at a survival level economically or at a survival level physically because of a doctor's diagnosis. And we begin to wonder, will I be able to make ends meet? Will I be able to put food on the table? Will I be able to pay the rent? Will I be able to pay for long-term care? Will I find a job? Will I keep my job? And then He talks about non-critical needs like your body, things pertaining to your appearance, the clothes that you're going to wear. Some of us are worried at the advancement promotion level of things. We're concerned about our legacy, our reputation, our acquisition. We're worried about whether we're going to move ahead. We're worried about raises or buying a new car. Some of us are worried about, will I be recognized appropriately? Will I get married? Will I get pregnant? Will I get my first choice of colleges? Will I make that sale this week? Will I get the deal? Will I ever own a home? Will I ever find a dress for the prom? If any of you have started justifying yourself on what I've already started talking about, stop. Stop self-justification right now. All of us are guilty. All of us put these things in wrong priorities at one time or another. There is no self-justification for putting any of that stuff ahead of God's points and principles. It's just not appropriate at all. So stop justification. See, Jesus asks a penetrating question. Literally, he says, is not life more than food? And isn't the body more than clothing? In the NIV, it adds a word. In the New International, it says, is not life more important than food? And isn't the body more important than clothing? Don't misunderstand me. He wants you dressed. I suspect, I've not done the Gallup poll survey yet, but I suspect there will be more time spent on Sunday morning around the world with two decisions. Number one, what am I going to wear to church? And number two, where am I going to eat as soon as I get out of here? And I suspect that more time may seriously be given to those two questions than to what does God want to do with me in His kingdom today. What is life all about? And whatever it is, shouldn't that be the focus of our concern? Is life about simply surviving and looking good in the process? Or is there something more substantial? If someone were to follow us around for a week and listen in on all of our conversations and have access to our financial records and our credit card statements, would they conclude that life for us is simply surviving and trying to look good in the process? Is that where our time, energy, and focus is invested? And consequently, do those two categories of things consume our worry time? Do they consume our thoughts? While we're thinking about that, Christ offers a little perspective about our needs. He gives us in this passage two illustrations to put our critical and non-critical needs in a proper perspective. Notice the first illustration he uses to address our critical needs. He talks about the birds of the air. They have all their critical needs met without worrying one bit. I've never heard a sparrow sing a sad song. I have never heard a dove sing a sad tune. They don't worry a bit. Our Heavenly Father feeds them, not nearly by nature and instinct. God established the food cycle, migration patterns, and etc. Aren't you and I more important? He is our Heavenly Father. He is merely their creator. You don't need to worry about that stuff. I think Shelley showed it to me this week. Somebody took a picture of Canadian honkers crossing the street. That wasn't you. I can't remember who showed it to me. Somebody on Facebook, and it was in the paper. Bunch of them at Barstow and Sunnyside, crossing from the ponding basin there. And they took a picture of it. Traffic was stopped. And that happens all the time right here. Happens all the time right here at this ponding basin. Big Canadian honkers who've made their permanent home in Clovis. And we all say about them every time we see them this time of year, isn't that cute? Isn't that cute? You know what dawned on me this morning? So I was thinking about that. Isn't that sad? Isn't that sad? You see, growing up, we didn't have Canadian honkers like this hanging out year-round. Only could see them twice a year. So they were flying north and flying south. And now Clovis has permanent residents of geese. How sad for them. They weren't created to live in a ponding basin behind a fence in Clovis. They were created to soar the skies from Argentina to Canada. They were created to see so much more than Clovis, California. Why do they stay? Because it's easy. It's easy. And I sometimes wonder if you and I have not become resident geese in God's economy. We settle for one little slice of what God has to give to us, and we miss out on the big picture. Providing food is not a problem with God. God's an expert, so worrying. Has worry ever made things worse for you? Most of the time. Jesus is not advocating irresponsible living. What he's advocating here is stress-free living. That is, you do what you know to do and you trust God. Birds live by instinct. You and I are supposed to live by the Spirit. Which one do you think is better? I would say walking in the Spirit is much better than instinct. They are programmed. You and I have a choice. The good part about being programmed is they don't worry. Good part about choice is we can live in the freedom of the Spirit. Then he uses another illustration for non-critical needs, the lilies of the field. The emphasis here is not survival, it's appearance. With no effort at all, lilies just look great. Have you ever seen flowers with a bad color combination? Only when people put them together. But you've never seen on a rose plant bad color combinations. You've never seen in a lily bad color combinations. They're gorgeous. If you don't believe, go to Belmont Nursery someday and just walk through all the floral area. Okay? Look at how beautiful those colors are. With no effort at all, they look great. You and I are commanded to observe the lilies of the field. So go to Belmont Nursery. Check out the latest fashion statements. I suggest to you today, God is an expert in fashion design. He's an expert at making things look good. Okay, I'm an exception. But he doesn't need any help or suggestions. The lily did nothing to produce its appearance. We do not serve a vanilla God. He's not conservative in his fashion. He has a flair. Just look around the room. You'll see the extent of his flair. To fear that God is going to make your life boring is to demonstrate you have a very limited knowledge of God. You need a good dose of the Bible or the Discovery Channel. You need to visit Yosemite or Sequoia. Take a drive over to Carmel. Then cruise your favorite clothing store and tell me who's got a better color palette. The point, if God gives this much attention to detail on a plant that will die in just a matter of days, what do you have to worry about? He designed us to live forever. You and I have no business worrying, getting stressed out over stuff. A dress for a prom, the right tie, the perfect car, a good haircut. Stuff. We do the best we can with what we've got, and we leave it at that. Your Heavenly Father is willing and able to go beyond what is basic. He knows how to be extravagant with us. You know what the problem is? I can't answer the problem because of my extreme intelligence. I can answer the question to what the problem is because it's found in verse 30. It's printed for us. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown in the fire, will he not much more clothe you? And then he defines the problem. What is it? Oh, you of little faith. The problem is a faith issue. We don't trust him. We don't think he is interested in us. We think he's overlooked us. When the fasten your seatbelt sign flashes, we think God has forgotten all about us, and we get angry. And in uncertainty, we think that he has lost power or interest in us. One of the things I've discovered in recent weeks of what anger really is, anger is an attitude that says, you owe me. You owe me. You did wrong to me. You owe me, and I'm mad. Until you take care of me, you're going to owe me. The opposite of that is guilt. Guilt, I feel bad because I owe you. But anger. And in times of uncertainty, we think God has forgotten us, and we get mad at him and say, God, you owe me. And he looks at us and he shakes his head and he says, oh, you who have such small faith. Verse 31, he repeats the command of verse 25. He says, I tell you, don't worry. If we serve a God who can be trusted and who has proven it, we have no business worrying about all of that. It doesn't even make sense. Then he chooses a different word to drive the point home. Jesus equates worry with seeking. What are we anxious about becomes the object of our attention and our affection. He says, what do you run after? For the pagans run after all these things. That word run after is the same word used a verse later, except with a prefix in front of it. It's the same word to seek. What you are running after, what you are seeking is what you are running after. And that's what you're worrying about. To worry about something is the evidence that we are seeking it. Don't spend all your time seeking these things. That's what people who don't trust in God do. Pagans, as Jesus said it. Run after. In the NAS, it's translated eagerly seek. In the Greek, frantically seek. For them, this is all life is about, is what they're running after. Uncertainty provides an opportunity for believers to let Christ shine through them. Whether it's personal uncertainty or national uncertainty. Whether it's the state of California that's in a drought. You and I should not be wringing our hands during this drought. That should not. This passage is telling us that's not our problem to worry about. We know whose hand is on the faucet. I can trust him. And he may be doing this, as I've said several times before, intentionally. Because there are leaders in this state and leaders in this government who give no acknowledgement to God that he exists or care about anything he has to say. They're trying through legislation to figure out how to get us more water. And the more water may come when confession occurs. But we shouldn't be worrying about it. It's not our issue. It doesn't mean we should be out there flooding our houses. It's not our worry. Your heavenly Father knows you need these things. How would you live if you heard God whispering in your ear 24/7, I know what you need, trust me. I know what you need, trust me. As a father, I said that many times to my kids. And God, my heavenly Father, when I'm in this book, tells me that again and again, trust me. I know what you need. What is life about? What are you and I to concern ourselves with? Verse 33 lays it out in very simple English. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. First, not down the road, not when I have time, not on occasion, before food, before fashion, before funds. Seek God's kingdom first. Shelly ticked me off a couple of weeks ago. She cleaned out her closet. And she thought because it was a good idea for her, it was a good idea for me. And so, cleaned out my, oh, that happened at your house too? Yeah, all right, on your, okay, I'm sorry, guys. And so we did. PF is really happy about that fact, okay? Prison Fellowship, really happy. They got a lot of stuff. It dawned on me as we were loading it up. First off, why did I need that much? Number two, thought about just throwing it away, but why would I do that? Somebody else could benefit. It's going to slow me down the next time I see something I just want to buy. Because really, from now on, when I buy, I want to think about the kingdom first. $40 for that shirt, or $40 for a kid at a school in Africa that I met last February. $40 makes a difference in eating for 2 months. Those of you who have been around New Hope for a while, you know it has been my goal for much of my ministry to pastor where church gave away 20% of what it took in. Always believed it should minimally be 10, never ever less than 10. I mean, if we believe, I believe, personally, I believe that God's principle of finances is it starts with giving Him right off the top. You don't have to believe that. I just can't make the Scripture say anything different. And I believe that God can do more with what I have left than what I can do with all of it. It's seeking first His. It's always a thought, if that's true of me personally, it ought to be true of the church body as a whole, and the church should always give away minimally 10% to missions and ministries outside its own purpose. But I always had a deep desire for years and shared it with the board, shared it with this church, wanted to get to 20%. And 3 years ago, we got to 19.65%. That 6.5 was over 5, so I got to bump it up to 20, all right? For the last 2 years, you guys have exceeded, together, we've exceeded the 20 and almost 21% this last year. Now I got a new desire to get to 25%. J.C. Penney started out with that, and you know where he ended up before he died? He gave away 90 and kept 10. Wow. That was amazing. So, that's been our desire personally, to get ours towards 20% as a family. So now before I buy that shirt or buy that car or buy this, God, will this make a difference in me getting to go to Africa next year? Will this make a difference in caring? Will this make a difference in the Actis family staying on the field? Seek first. Ask that first. Not what can I afford, but God, what do you want? If we are to concern ourselves with the furtherance of the kingdom of God and the righteous standard of God, you see, the same Greek word seek in verse 32, run after, is the same one in verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God. But in the first one, there's a prefix put in front of it, which turns the word to a selfish seeking. What are you looking for? Are you looking for food and fashion? Are you looking for faith in God? Are you looking for personal needs? Are you looking for kingdom causes? The kingdom, the values and agenda of God's kingdom. What is that? Focus on what God is up to. Finding those who are not in the kingdom and making them kingdom people. Righteousness. What's righteousness? A standard of morality, a divine code of ethics that affects all of our relationships, family, community, and national. And man, if this country was ever, ever in a righteousness crisis, it is today. Whereas in times of uncertainty, the tendency to abandon our values and character and do whatever it takes to survive, Jesus says, no, seek righteousness even more. It's easy to be good when being good serves our purposes. Everybody does that. It's difficult when it doesn't. That's when righteousness shines like a light put on a hill. Look at the promise. All those other things, God says, I'll take care of. I'm not telling you that food is unimportant. I'm not telling you clothing is unimportant. I'm just telling you that they are less important than the most important. Jesus says, you look after my deal and I'll look after your stuff. Don't go through life stressed out over that. Besides, where do you think it came from in the first place? Your talents, your opportunities, your breaks, your education, your chance encounters. That was you? You did all that? Really? Don't worry about your ability to sustain God's blessings. Seek His kingdom, and He'll look after ours. And the whole time God is asking, is there anybody down there concerned about my kingdom and my righteousness? Jesus wants to know, is anybody down there worried about people who are disconnected to life? Is there anybody down there worried about the next generation of teenagers coming along playing Charlie Charlie? Is anybody worried about the children who have never heard of the love of Christ? Is anybody worried about kids who were kidnapped and thrust into the sex trade and have no control of their life at all? Is anybody worried about the people in other nations who still haven't heard? How about your boss? How about your neighbor? How about your best friend? Who's going to tell them? Not me. I'm worried about my job, my economy, and my retirement. Can I let you in on a secret as I wrap this up? The people who are most aware of God's intervention in their lives are the ones whose agendas are closest to Him. When, unlike Elijah, we don't forget that He used a raven to feed me when there was no other source of food. That He used a widow woman who was going to make her last cake and die, but God saw to it that her barrel of meal and her cruse of oil never ran out. Not in abundance, but enough for the very next meal every single time they went there. They don't forget that God enabled Elijah to stand on top of a mountain, face an entire evil nation, and watch God send fire from heaven. We can't forget those things. The people who are aware of God's intervention in their lives are the ones who will allow God's agenda to be their agenda. The people who have made the swap live with an uncanny sense that God is here. They are in on what He's up to. We say, God, where are you? And God says, I'm where I've always been. What are you doing here? Uncertainty is not evidence of God's inactivity or His change of agenda. We cannot afford to be inactive or change agendas either. The uncertainty we are facing has created enormous ministry opportunities. We can't afford to miss them by getting caught up in our own deal of fear. Here's the promise. Concern yourself with what concerns Him, and all the things will be added to you by Him. He says, you take care of my deal, I'll take care of your stuff. So what do? What's our action step as you leave here today? One simple thing. Memorize verse 27. You still have your Bible open? Somebody still got it open? Who's got it? Verse 27, chapter 6. Karen, read it out loud. Use your outside voice like you're yelling at John. Memorize that verse. Who of you by worry can add an hour to your life? Get up tomorrow morning and make that trade just for the day. Say, today, when I begin worrying about me, I'm going to offload that on you, God, and I'm going to look for ways to further your kingdom. I'm not going to allow uncertainty to take a toll on my character. One short verse. Can worry add an hour to my day? So, God, here's my worry. I'm going to seek first your kingdom. So, in uncertainty, we pray. We remember, we seek, and if you want a touchdown, come back next Sunday to see what the fourth thing is that we do when the fasten your seatbelt sign flashes in your screen. Let's pray. Father, for the life that you offer to share with us, it's a worry-free life. It's not a problem-free life. It's not a pleasant circumstance life. It's not only good things happen to me life. It is a life of sufficiency that's rooted in you. Father, help us grow up that we live that kind of life. I pray that the desire of many of our hearts will be that we no longer be people of little faith, but we will become people of pure faith that is rooted in a great God. Build our faith in you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Don't run over any of the parking posse.